I love being here with you guys. This just rocks. I love it. Don't you love coming to the house of the Lord? You know, and it's not, obviously not a building. It's the church is not a building. It's God's people. And, you know, we come together and just see God. You know, we see God in one another. That's the amazing thing. It's an amazing thing that, as we learned last week, a holy God would dwell in a sinful person like you and me. Isn't it? And when you encounter that, it's just incredible, miraculous. So the next time you read about the Red Sea or fire falling down from heaven, you go, well, I want to see miracles. Just look in the mirror. For real. Because we should either be dead or in hell. Instead, we're filled with the power of God. Incredible. Man, let's come together in agreement this morning. And just ask God to come and speak to us and have his way in this place. Can we do that? Go ahead and take the hand of the person next to you. Father, we thank you for your holy presence in this place. We're awestruck at such a love, such a relentless, perfect, holy love. And we welcome you, Father God, to come as we sit at your feet, and to come and speak to us this morning. We would rather humble ourselves than be humbled, so we submit ourselves to you. We don't have any wisdom or strength or might in of ourselves. It's all from you. You see every heart in this place, Lord God. You see every thought from afar, the past, present, and future. You are the eternal one. So we submit to your lordship and the move of your wind in this place. Come and speak to your church, Lord. May we have an ear to hear, Holy Spirit, what you would say to this church this day. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone said, amen. Amen. You may be seated. Well, Revelation chapter 1, look with me at verse 19. Write these things which you have seen, and the things which are, and the things which will take place after this. The mystery of the seven stars, which you saw in my right hand in the seven golden lampstands. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands which you saw are the seven churches. Look with me at verse 16, referencing back to this mystery he alluded to. Verse 16, it says, he had in his right hand the seven stars. Let's stop there. Jesus tells John to write down, you ready? This mystery. Remember last week we talked about divine mysteries? We're not done. He says there's a mystery specifically concerning the church, these seven stars that I hold in my hand and the representations of them, and the golden lampstand, these seven branches. And I want you to write down this concerning the church. Now, we'll take note, the first thing is that, and I love this, is that Jesus says he holds the church right in his hand. I like that. That comforts my troubled soul at times when I see the state the church is in. I mean, it starts off looking at what we picked up last week in verse 4. It says, John, to the seven churches which are in Asia. So Jesus is about now to greet the church. These specific seven churches, Asia is not necessarily China, Japan, but actually Turkey, Asia Minor. And there's these seven churches he's writing to, and it's important you understand these churches that he says he holds in his hand. The things that we're going to read over the following couple months, it can sound like he's actually not holding them in his hand too well because they're a mess. Looking at these seven churches, look with me, and if you could put that up on the screen here, we'll just briefly cover these because we're going to get into detail in the following months. But the first church is Ephesus. This church was like New York City. This is like the main hub or the mother church of all churches. And the lesson we'll learn is this: a group of people that got religion over relationship. They started off genuine and organic and sincere, but they chose the hype of their deeds and their organization over the presence of the Holy Spirit. They lost their first love. But Jesus says, it's okay, I'm holding you in my hand. The next church is Smyrna, which means myrrh, or crushed but pleasing. There's this group of stars he holds in his hand. He says, I know you're going through tough times, and you just feel like you can't take anymore, and you're crushed to pieces, ground into the dirt, but I want you to know that your faith and trust in me pleases me like a sweet-smelling aroma, says the Lord. Blesses the Lord. This next church, Pergamos, which is abbreviation for two words. It actually means pervert or monogamy. In other words, polygamous. There's a specific group of Christians, he says, that you love me, but you love the world, and you've mixed the two together where you can't differentiate the two anymore. But I still have you in my hand. The next church, Thyatira, which means continual sacrifice. He speaks to the church. He's going to say, there's a group of you that acknowledge my sacrifice once and for all for the sin of man, and that was enough to open heaven's gates for you, but you're still trying to earn your way into my good grace. But it's okay. Why? I'm holding you in my hand, huh? Yeah. Next, Sardis. Interesting. Sardis means prince of joy. But here's the thing. This group of people had life on the outside, but they were dead on the inside. There's a group of Christians that walk around and they act like the Prince of Joy. They're Sardis. They're, man, God is so good. Hallelujah. They got all the Christian knees down. They know their Bible verses. Their Bible is so marked up, it looks like a coloring book or something, and you just go, oh man, they got so much joy. Well, that's at the outside. On the inside, they're depressed and they're a mess. But you'd never know it. But him who has eyes of blazing fire, he sees it, doesn't he? He knows the deal. So if you're one of the Sardis believers today, know this. He is holding you. Work with me, people. In his hands. Yeah. After Sardis, Philadelphia. Now we know what that means, of course. Brotherly love. He says there's that group of believers where they're just whack out crazy in love with each other. They care about each other. They have this affection for another. Man, they're the ones that, like, when it's like 11 o'clock after Saturday night and we're like turning the lights off, it's time to go, guys. We got to lock up. You know, they're just that Philadelphia Christian. They just love God, and they know that that's synonymous with loving his body or his people. And there's a group of people, man, they're just like that. Well, this last church, Laodicea, it means rule of the people. That's that group of Christians that they think they're in charge. And they've got a mixture of all these other churches going on. And Jesus speaks to them and says, I'd rather you be hot or cold, but you're in between. You're lukewarm. And it's all because you think that you're in charge. And it's about your will and your desire over mine. But Jesus says, don't worry, I'm holding it in my hands, and I'm doing a work. Now, I find it incredible, amazing, that he writes to this church, and he writes to the seven churches. Now, I want you to take note of this, guys. The word, the number seven in numerology has a specific meaning. Now, many of us think it means completion. It actually does. It does, but it doesn't. In numerology, actually, three is completion, and seven is perfection. They actually can mean both. See, the thing is, in our philosophy of truth and the way that we are in our society, we kind of work on a certain system from the Greek Platonic dualism, which means it's either or. And it's not necessarily the case with the truth in the Bible because, Jesus is the Son of God, but he's also God. For example, I'm a son, but I'm also a father. It's not either or, it's both and. You see what I'm saying? And now you might go, well, how is that relevant? It's really relevant, really important, because listen closely. He just said about the church, not only are you complete, you're also perfected. See, there were more than seven churches in Asia. But he chose this number for a reason. Everything in the Bible is there for a reason. Okay? And when he says, I'm writing to the seven church, it's almost like he's saying, I'm writing to the perfect church. Complete and perfected. Now, that's his view. It's not our view. See, from my view as a human being, I go, the church is a mess. I mean, about 2 months ago, we went through some stats currently of where the church is at today, just in our country. Oh my gosh, 7,000 churches closing a year. There's 3,000 that actually start and open up, but 4,000 that close. But one couple stats, one was 3,500 people a day leave the church in this country. It's falling apart. 1,700 pastors a month in this country leaving the pulpit, quitting, discouraged, done. We live in a society that stats that we looked at was that a pastor is seen integrity-wise just under a used car salesman. That's just how the world looks at the church. And that's just, now I know this can sound like a drag, and you go, well, Dave, how do you reconcile that Jesus says it's seven? There's complete, there's perfection, because it's both and. We're perfect and we're not perfect. It's not one or the other. You see what I'm saying? And what we're going to do today is read some things that Jesus has to say to us as the church to help us see the church like he sees the church. Because we see ourselves as one big dysfunctional mess, and that's what we believe. It's either or. No. Yet, practically speaking, yeah, we're a dysfunctional mess. We're sinners saved by grace, for sure. But it's not just that. It's also he's completed the church and he's done everything that needs to be done for us and he's given us everything we need to live a godly life. It's done. It's finished. Don't you love those words? It's finished. And we as a church have to start believing and seeing like Jesus, him who holds the seven stars in his right hand. He's holding us, church. But we're taking our eyes off Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, you see. And the things that Jesus is about to say to us are deep. They're full of depth and richness and power and promise. Let's take a look at what Jesus has to say to the church. After greeting the seven churches in verse 4, he says, grace to you and peace from him who is and was and is to come, and from the seven stars who are before his throne. Stop there. The first thing you want to take note of, guys, that what makes the church perfect, are you ready? Perfected. Right away, the greeting says it all. Grace and peace. Say it out loud with me. Grace and peace. I love where the Holy Spirit just moves John, and he takes this New Testament word, charis, or we get the word charisma, and this Old Testament word, shalom, or peace, and just makes them Siamese twins. You know, just pops them right together, and you see throughout the epistles, it's always grace and peace, grace and peace. These are the keys to the church being seen as perfect. See, moving backwards, we don't have peace like we need to have peace. When I think of peace, I think of Peter, James, John, and the boys there in the boat with the storm, right? And they're a mess. You know what they don't have? They don't have peace. They think they're separated from God. They do. They think Jesus is snoozing and losing and not caring about what's going on in their lives. They don't see. Whenever you think God is distant, he doesn't care, you don't have peace. And the byproduct of that is, you're not interested in the things of God. You know, we talked about churches and the state that the church is in. I was looking at kind of, you know, what is it, Lord? What are the reasons people don't like to come to the house of the Lord? You know, I asked the worship team earlier, I said, what reasons do you think that they don't have? And that whole issue of peace definitely came up. But I want to read backwards with some of these reasons why people don't go to church today. They don't feel that connection or peace with God, all right? And I'll start off out of these eight, and I'll go backwards. The first reason people don't like to come into church is because they have to work. The second one is there's a ball game on, sports. Number six, I can just watch church on TV. I don't need to go. I've got my pastor on a screen. Number five, I am enjoying things that the Bible says are sinful. Number four, someone at church hurt me. Number three, God seems distant and dead. Number two, Christians are hypocrites. And lastly, they feel condemned, separated. The top two reasons people don't like to come to the house of the Lord is because they feel condemned and they feel God is dead and distant. You know what it is? There's no peace. There's no peace. There's no connection. That's what peace does. It's like, Lord, I'm not separate from you. I'm one with you, and you are with me, and you'll never leave me. I tell you, no matter what's going on around you, when you know that, you're at peace. More and more in these last days, the Church of Jesus Christ needs the peace of God that passes understanding of the mind. How do we get it? Grace. Grace. That unmerited favor of God, that charis. Some people go, are you one of those charismatic Daves? You betcha. I'm as charismatic as they come. I want all the grace I can get. Because when someone says, I'm not charismatic, in a biblical term, what they're saying is, I'm not about grace. Because grace is God's favor. It's his empowerment. It's his ability. It's his might. You can't have peace without an outpouring of his grace upon you. When we went through the book of Jude, we did one study. If you weren't here, I encourage you to go back and check it out, called A Slave of Grace. And in that study, man, we just saw that was the foundation. That's where everything comes from in our walk with God, is this understanding. The church is not experiencing favor with God. They're not receiving his favor, his blessing. That's why we're not at peace. You know, I remember when I went to start a church, Calvary Chapel, Boca Raton, back in 1992, and I had left Calvary Fort Lauderdale to go do that, and I had been going to Calvary since it was like 20 people. So from 92 to 93, I really didn't go back. I was pretty busy. At least during a service, I didn't go back. And so a year later, I went back to a service on a Saturday evening, I think it was, and I noticed something. You know what it was? I didn't know anybody. How could that be? How could I be at a church when it was 20 people and I leave when it's a couple thousand people and I'm gone for a year and I come back and besides some staff, I hardly know anybody? And I noticed that the body of Christ at that point is so transient, so flaky, like sheep, just all over the place. They don't know where they're going. You know what? They're not at peace. The body of Christ is not at peace. That's why we're so quick to run and leave this fellowship and that fellowship and nitpick and criticize and do all this. And man, if someone leaves a church because someone hurt them, that's because they're not at peace. Well, man, the color and the paint on this wall and a black ceiling? Really, Dave? Come on. Is this a church or is it a cave? What's the deal? And people get caught up in this stuff and I'm like, wow, restless, no peace. Why? Because they're not about grace. They're not feeding on the unmerited favor of God. No, they know the word, they know the doctrine, and some of you have taught it in classes, but that doesn't mean you're drinking of it. That doesn't mean it's exuding from your spiritual pores. How do you know? You just got peace. And you've got this unity with the body of Christ. No matter what happens, you're solid. The church is being shaken in these last days. When we see, you know, 79 pastors leaving a month in the church and 3,500 people a day leaving the church and all this going on, I'm going, what's the answer, Lord? Because you see the church seven. You see it complete and perfected. You've provided all that we need, but we're not getting that. We're missing the boat, so to speak. And so Jesus writing and says, oh, write to my beautiful bride. Write to my body. Write to my church. I want them to know the foundation importance of this favor and the peace that follows from it and who it comes from. See, if someone's going to give you a check, who's giving it to you matters, right? That's why they ask for your license. That's why some people say, no, we need a direct deposit with you, buddy, because we know you, right? We look at your credit. We need. But see, when you know who it's coming from, man, it inspires a whole different level of joy about what's being offered to you. Am I right? So here he says, grace and peace to you. What does he say here in verse 4? Look at this. From who is, who was, and who is to come. Right there, we see a picture of the Father, the eternal one, right? The eternal God. He's not linear time like we are, where we experience things in a moment, this bubble of time. No, he's the God of the big eternal moment where everything is now. Yesterday is now. Tomorrow is now. It's always right then. Now, why is that so important to understand? Well, to illustrate it, I would share with you a little study I was doing on a star. You guys have heard of the dog star before. You ever heard of the dog star? It's a name of a star that we look up in the sky by the name of Sirius. Let me read a couple of facts here. You'll get a kick out of this. This is amazing. It's the brightest star in the sky that we see at night, all right? Brighter than the sun, 25 times brighter than our sun, the star. And it's 10,000 degrees Kelvin hot. That's a hot star. It's 9 light years away, and at 186,000 miles per second, if you could move that fast, you'd get there in 9 years. That's how far away it is. In other words, when we look up and we see the light of that star, that illumination began 9 years ago. But we're seeing it now. It's amazing. I mean, imagine for a moment if you could get a telescope, if such a thing existed, and you could see this dog star, the star Sirius, and see yourself 9 years in the future or 9 years in the past, but you're there now. That's God. That's God. There's an incredible verse in Ecclesiastes that refers to this, and let me read this to you real quick. Amazing, amazing, amazing. Ecclesiastes chapter... You got it up there already? Beautiful. Verse 15, it says, that which has already been and what is to be has already been, and God requires an account of what is past. Let me read that again. That which has already been and what is to be has already been, and God requires an account of what is past. Basically, that verse is just saying that God is the God of eternal now. It's like yesterday and tomorrow all comes down to that moment. Now, why is this so important, and what's the connection where Jesus writing to his church, his perfect, complete church, and he says, I want to give you grace and peace, and it's coming from him who is the big, eternal now. Are you following me? This is deep. This is good. Listen closely. Your sins of yesterday or tomorrow and now are all covered right now. Right now. His grace is good enough for everything you ever did. See, we have a tendency to go, well, that sin, that was 9 years ago. Not with God, it's right now. Right now. As good as you were at denial, it's right now. The sins of your future, 9 years away from now, it's not 9 years away, it's right now. God sees it. But it's okay. Because his grace is sufficient. Does that give you peace? Hallelujah. I mean, we could end there today. That's grace and peace from the God of the eternal now. When you really drink that in, you know what it does? It overflows to the rest of the parts of his body. Gossip disappears like a nasty gaseous vapor. Slander, division, gossiping, grumbling. It goes away. In other words, the completeness and perfection as Jesus sees his body now manifests itself. All because of grace. But it's important we see who's giving the grace. It's one thing if I give you a check that you didn't earn. Money, that big deal. But when God says, I'm giving you unmerited favor, I did not spare my one and only son. What would I withhold from you? I'm giving everything to you. I'm giving you the keys to the kingdom. Wow. That's big. It's huge. You know why he does that? Grace. Grace. Anybody got peace yet? What makes the church perfect? Grace and peace from the eternal now God. What else makes the church perfect? Well, he says this grace and peace not only comes from him who is the eternal one, it also comes, look at this closely here, it says it also comes from the seven spirits who are before his throne. So he says this grace and peace not only comes from God the Father, the eternal now, it also comes from the seven spirits of God before the throne. Now, I heard one guy teach one time that the Holy Spirit is he's seven different spirits. That's not what this is saying here. The best way to know what the Bible teaches, you ready? Let the Bible teach it. Right? It's not about your opinion or what your favorite teacher says. Just look for the Bible to explain the Bible, and the dumbest of sheep will go, aha! You know, you'll get it. You'll get it. So look at a couple of these verses here that really give the answer concerning the seven spirits, if you would. If you look with me, Revelation chapter 3, verse 1, it says, and to the angel of the church of Sardis write, these things says he who has the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. Look with me also at chapter 4, verse 5. It says, and from the throne proceeding lightning and thunderings and voices, seven lamps of fire were burning before the throne, which are the seven spirits of God. Chapter 5, verse 6. And I looked, and behold, in the midst of the throne and of the four living creatures, and in the midst of the elders stood a lamb, as though it had been slain, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent out in all the earth. What you're looking at here, guys, and we'll confirm this with a really intense scripture, this is the Holy Spirit we're talking about, the seven manifold presence of the Holy Spirit. You see the symbolism saying something to us. Even in Zechariah chapter 4, I believe it is, where it talks about this lampstand with seven branches. What flows from the seven branches? The oil of God. And what does it bring? The light of God. See, God says, I want my people to have grace and peace. It's going to come from the eternal now. You can bank on this favor. It's unlimited. It's beautiful. And I'm going to give you this illumination, this light that comes from my presence. The fullness of my presence. Here's where the scripture really gives some insight concerning this sevenfold reign of the Holy Spirit. Isaiah chapter 11, look at this. It says, there shall come forth a rod from the stem of Jesse, a messianic scripture to be sure, and a branch shall grow out of his roots, and the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him. The spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. Here the scripture is telling us that the God providing for his church has given this grace and peace from the Father, and he's manifesting, illuminating, opening our eyes to what it is through his presence, the fullness of his presence. I asked them to put a chart up here of these seven manifest presence here, the first one being that where the Spirit of the Lord rests upon us. Of course, we know that Jesus promised that when he would left, the Spirit of God would come, what? Upon them. That word in the Greek, epi, or the distribution of God's presence and his power there, the power of God. Secondly, the wisdom, or the ability to have the discernment of God. We watched Jesus walk in that many times. And of course, understanding, the personal revelation of God. And I'm going to read you a scripture. There's so many incredible insights to this one trait of the Holy Spirit, of understanding and personal revelation. Let me read this to you. Paul gives some insight to this whole blessing of the Holy Spirit in Ephesians, where he says in chapter 3, verse 1, that I, Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, for you the Gentiles, if indeed you have heard of the dispensation of the grace of God, which was given to me for you, How that by revelation or revealing, if you would, he made known to me the mystery as I have briefly written already, by which when you read, you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ, which in other ages was not made known to the sons of men, as it has been known, revealed by the Spirit to his holy apostles and his prophets. Also look with me at verse 14, as Paul is praying this prayer, and I believe it's for the understanding that comes from the Holy Spirit. He says, I bow my knees to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, from whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might through his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width and length and depth and height, to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Hallelujah. I mean, the Holy Spirit has been sent to us, sent out from the throne, from the Lamb, right? And he's sent out to open our minds, to illuminate us, personal revelation and revealing of his heart to us, of his mind for us. Are we experiencing? Well, see, in the eternal perspective, it's complete. It's perfected. But it's not either or, it's both and, just like the deity of Christ. Catching that? So it's a matter of, yes, we're the seven churches perfected, but there's still a present tense work going on. We're learning to have this illumination, this knowledge from the presence of the Holy Spirit of who we really are. I mean, let me tell you what, if we really grasped a hold of that one alone, that's probably my favorite out of all these right here that I'm looking at, because I'm going, man, if we just got that down, if we just looked in the mirror and saw us like you see us, there would be no division in the body of Christ. Unbelievers would never walk in the church and go, I just feel like God is distant and dead. Unbelievers would not walk in the church and go, man, a bunch of hypocrites. They wouldn't see it. They wouldn't walk in the church and go, I just feel condemned, because there'd be so much grace flowing from the people of God, the body of Christ. They would go, and I'm such a sinner, but I feel so loved. His kindness, the kindness of God, just flows by grace through his people, where I just feel accepted. I'm convicted of my sin, but I don't feel pushed away, though. It's kind of ironic. It's crazy. That's how people get saved, by the way. That's what grace does. That's what the Holy Spirit does through his people. That's what the church in these last days desperately needs. We don't need more gimmicks. We don't need more hype. We don't need more charismatic speakers and greater songs and more money and this and that. We need more grace. We need more power. I mean, guys, just know my heart. We take time. We work on this building, for example, because it's a blessing from God, and we want to be a good steward of it. But the day is coming where we won't even be allowed to meet in a building anymore. And we'll be underground, and we'll be meeting in others' houses and persecuted because, you know, the gates of hell shall not prevail against the church because of grace. Because his grace, his favor, gave us the keys of the kingdom. And if God's for us, hallelujah, no one can be against us. Amen? It's his presence that opens our eyes to that. It's the Holy Spirit. So many churches today, we think we can do it without the Holy Spirit. We do. And what happens is that building or that church on the corner, it represents a morgue. So people walk in, they go, it's kind of dead. Well, that's because it is. That's because they're Sardis. They're dead. Oh, joyful on the outside, but inside it's just spiritually dead. There's no grace. There's no peace. The Holy Spirit isn't fire. The oil isn't flowing, man. The wind's not blowing. I love these beautiful metaphors and symbols and literal things that took place in the Bible where you see the Holy Spirit, you know, Jesus breathes, pneuma, spirit, breath, breathes on him, receives. Receive who? The Holy Spirit. Just three or four or five of the sevenfold Spirit? No. The fullness. Receive the fullness of the Spirit. When you do that, man, everything changes. Oh, the next thing we see here beside knowledge, counsel, the instruction of God. Anybody in need of instruction today? Yeah. You know, and that's the place to go. It ain't necessarily, you know, going to your counselor or your psychiatrist or your pastor or your elder. Go to God For real, that's what the church is missing. We rely more on the counsel and wisdom of man than the counsel of the Holy Spirit, the anointing from the Holy One, 1 John 2, that says he lives within us. You don't need teachers. He wasn't making teachers obsolete. It's a legitimate part of the fivefold ministry. But he's saying the priority, the spearhead, is the anointing. Who's that? The Holy Spirit, the one that gives you counsel. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the church. Boom, I like that. But we're not listening. He's talking, we're just not listening. It's already complete, it's perfected. Everything is in sync and moving and aligned. We just have to align ourselves with the way he calls the shots. And all of a sudden, we'll see that perfect church. We can. Oh, that's not possible. Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Be perfect as your Heavenly Father is perfect. It's not you. It's his presence. It's his presence. Oh, fifthly, the might of God comes to the Holy Spirit, the ability of God, the knowledge or having the thoughts of God. And seven, the fear of the Holy Spirit, which basically is a revelation of his presence, where there brings a reverence and a holiness and a humility. Has the Holy Spirit ever done that for you? Where, you know, you're worshiping God and you just sense his presence to the point where you're like, I feel I can't even talk. Can you imagine if we walk in the spirit of fear, it's the gift of the Holy Spirit, when we talk to one another, there'd be no arrogance. People would not condescend when they talk to one another. The fear of the Lord that comes, the presence, the illumination of the Holy Spirit, there would be a whole different dynamic. The ground at the foot of the cross would truly be level when we move amongst one another then. The Holy Spirit gives us that gift. He does. And you know what he does it by? Grace. It's just a favor. And when you receive that, man, the peace of God comes. And I don't care what your hurricane looks like. Jesus shows up and he says, I know you thought I was dead. I know you thought I was sleeping. I know you thought my promises weren't true. But I'm here to speak peace and cause the storm. And it's not because you earned it or you were spiritual. It's totally grace. Right? They were accusing God of pretty much of being a liar and indifferent and not caring. And instead of rejecting them and saying, you know what, you guys can drown, I'm going to go find 12 other guys, right? As some of us would do. He blesses them. Why? Because of you're listening. Hallelujah. First service is still waking up, but you guys are coming around here. That's good. So grace and peace is what makes the perfect church, the perfected, complete church, right? And it comes from him who's the eternal now. Our eyes are open to it, the illuminating presence of the fullness of the Holy Spirit, that Jesus said, it's greater that I leave so I can send who? The Holy Spirit. That all these things can be rocking on all cylinders in your life as a church, as a believer. But it not only comes through the eternal now, the one, the Father, or the Holy Spirit. This beautiful picture of the Trinity is complete when it talks about the Son. Hallelujah. Look with me back at Revelation chapter 1. We're actually going to read through the rest of this, looking at verse 4. It says, John, the seven churches which are in Asia, grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before the throne. And this, and understand, each time you see this word and, for you grammar students, that's a conjunction. It's like there's a connection and a quality that's taking place with each one of these three, the Father, the Spirit, the Son, and. Remember you 70s children, a conjunction, junction, what's your function? Remember that, right? That's an important word there that tells us there's this connection between the triune Godhead who's giving us what? Grace and? Not good enough. That's giving us?
Grace.
And? Okay. So it's coming from God the Father, God the Spirit, and verse 5, and from the Son, from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, the ruler over the kings of the earth, to him who loved us. Who loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood, and to make us kings and priests to his God and Father, and to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Stop there. Wow. But Dave, I'm confused. It just said that it was Jesus. It's God the Father. So is Jesus God or is he the Son? It's not either or, it's both and. He is the Son and he is God the Father. We're actually going to read that here in a minute. They're one and the same, but they're different. And if you're going, well, I don't understand that, do you want to worship a God you think you can understand completely? You're worshiping creation if you can understand it. Okay. The creator, that hyperdimensional being that we're just, you know, three-dimensional, check it out. He's way above our pea brains perception. He really is. He's eternal now. He's omnipresent. He's omniscient. And he's been manifested through the promise of his one and only Son, who the Bible says, check it out, is the faithful witness. Faithful witness. John chapter 18, when he stood before Pilate, Pilate therefore said to him, are you a king then? And Jesus answered, you say rightly that I am a king. For this cause I was born, and for this cause I have come into the world, that I should bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice. John chapter 1, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Stop there. Wow. We're reading here, guys, that Jesus is the faithful. He says, hey, I came, and I came to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth. And the truth is, I came to bring grace. That's what I've come to do. There's no strings attached. Many, when a gift looks too good, we go, okay, where's the hammer drop? Where's the fine little details in the writing? There's something I'm missing, because when something looks too good to be true, it usually is, right? And that's true, but not with God. It's really that good. He's a faithful witness, and that's why the scripture calls him just such. What else does it say about him besides that he's a faithful witness? It says, secondly, that he's the firstborn over the dead, the firstborn. Now, there are those that try and discredit the deity of Christ by looking at the scripture and say, see, Jesus was born. I need you to understand, guys, this firstborn is just a title, and it means authority. It's kind of like you look at Michelle Obama and you go, she's our first lady, but she's not the first lady. It's just, it's meaning a certain position. You see what I'm saying? So what is being said about him who gives us grace and peace? Because this grace and peace, we understand those facets from God the Father and God the Holy Spirit, but God the Son, it says that this grace and peace comes from someone who's firstborn and has authority over what? Death. He has authority over death. In other words, because of the grace that comes through God the Son, death has no sting for the believer. In other words, we don't fear tomorrow. We don't fear disease. We don't fear a nuclear bomb. We don't fear our country falling apart. We grieve over it because it's sinful. But we don't walk in a spirit of fear, do we? Because we've got grace. We've got favor from God. And when you're drinking that in based on the God that says, I have authority over death and you shall never die, I got so much peace because of what Jesus says. This area is so rich. It's so pregnant with life for the church today. Oh my gosh, we could camp all day on just one of these things, but to try to be true to the text, forgive me if I'm overloading your brain a little bit with so many things here, but just in these four verses, we could spend 4 months. There's so much here. Well, the next thing besides the firstborn from the dead, it says he's the ruler, I love this, over all the kings of the earth. So this grace I get from God that gives me peace, I go, God, you're in charge. It's not the president. It's not the emperor of our country. There's a message in that. It's not a king of England or queen of England. It's not the IRS, praise God. It's none of those things. It's Jesus. I have total peace because he's the ruler over everything and everyone that was ever created. Does that give you peace? Not only is he the ruler, I love this, it says, to him who loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. Write this down. Jesus the Son is the Redeemer. He loves us. How does he give us grace that brings peace? He loved us so much that he washed us in his blood. If the church was really walking in the empowerment of that truth alone, the church would look completely different. You know what I love telling God? It's speaking to my own soul. I just go, God, you really love me. I like to joke around, but I'm almost serious about it, where I just go, God, I know I'm your favorite. Well, that's heresy. God doesn't, it's not like God of favoritism. Well, we're all his favorite. He's only got one body. You like that? I just came up with that. That's a good one. I like that one. He's only got one body, so we're all his favorite if you're part of his body. He loved me so much, he redeemed me. I had no hope, but he rescued me from the pit, man, and washed me in his own sinless blood. And you know what he did it by? Does that give you peace? It sure does me, man. I love this. It says, and he made us kings and priests to his God and Father. To him be the glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Oh, check this out. The last thing I want you to write this down is he is the recreator. I haven't read that in the Bible before. What's that word, recreator? I kind of made that one up, but bear with me for a minute. Because he created us, but we were a mess. And we were completely disqualified to serve in his house. We were kind of like the tribe of Dan prior to Sinai, that we were going to be priests and prophets and kings and all these things, but yet because we worshiped the golden calf, we were basically disqualified and only the Levites could serve in the house of God. But God came in and recreated the order. Now we all can be Levites and serve in his house. He recreated the whole scene that we blew up with the nuclear bomb. He did it. He's recreated the whole scene, a whole new life. The old is gone, the new has come. We're now all of a sudden, we have a destiny to serve at his side as his bride, priest, people who represent God to others. In the millennial reign, that's what we'll be doing. Do you know that? You've heard it said before, earth is boot camp for the millennial reign. That's what it is. It's preparation time, right? Listen to this verse here, Revelation chapter 5. It says, and he has made us kings and priests to our God, and we shall reign on the earth. That's the millennial reign. Incredible. He's recreated us from someone who is disqualified, a mess, incapable, incompetent, but because he washed us in his blood, filled us with his spirit, he made us new. And he did it by, can you say that word too much? I can't. Because I want more and more and more. I just want a spiritual IV from heaven. Just intravenous grace. What do you think? Just the favor, power, might, and ability of God all the time. I want to be the most radical Jesus freak 24/7. And I can't do it unless my IV. But some Christians, we yank it out. I think I can do it on my own strength. But it's not by power nor by might, says the Lord, but by my spirit. They were learning that when they were trying to rebuild the temple. We're still learning that while we're building this temple. Don't pull the IV out. If you're wondering what that means, pray about it. Get the counsel from the Holy Spirit. He'll tell you. Closing out today, verse 7, it says, behold. And here we have the first prophecy in the book of Revelation. And man, it's a big one. He is coming. Behold, he is coming with clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. And all the tribes of the earth will mourn because of him. Even so, amen. Listen closely. Guys, we have a promise, and this promise is by grace. We don't deserve for Jesus to come back and rescue us. He's coming back because it's unmerited favor. He's coming back for us. It's that simple. Now, there are those who are beholding. They're like, I can't wait to see you face to face. There are those who could care less and don't even acknowledge Jesus as Messiah. And the scripture alludes to those in a specific prophecy that's spoken of in Zechariah chapter 13, where it says, and one will say, what are these wounds between your arms? And then they will answer, those which I was wounded in the house of my friends. Right there's a reference point there in verse 7 of Israel that will see Messiah when he comes back and go, that was the lamb that we slayed. They're not looking for him, but there are those who are beholding and they're looking for him. They can't wait to see Jesus because they know when they see him, they'll be like him. Do you know that? Will be transformed these lowly bodies to heavenly bodies like his. right at that moment. You didn't earn it. It was a gift. You don't have to work at it. You don't have to be Thyatira and send you a sacrifice. He's already completed you and perfected you, church. He's already done it. Now, who are we talking about? The firstborn over all creation, the first fruits of the resurrection. But he's more than that. I said we were close. I lied. Forgive me. Verse 8. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, says the Lord, who is and who was and is to come, the Almighty. Well, Dave, back there in verse 4, it talked about God the Father being this triune God, the God of the eternal now, who was and is to come. And now it's Jesus. First it said God was the Father, but now it says that he's the Alpha, where it begins and when it ends, and he's the Almighty. Now, Jehovah's Witnesses, their brain is like an egg on a frying pan with this one, which I, in a sick, warped way, enjoy inducing that experience. You know, and there's lots of other scriptures you can do. Would you like to read a couple of them? Doesn't matter, because we're going to anyway. Yeah. Listen closely to these scriptures concerning the deity of Jesus Christ. Oh, this is so powerful. Isaiah chapter 41, verse 1, keep silent before me, O coastlands, and let the people renew their strength. Let them come near. Let them speak. Let us come near together for judgment. Isaiah 44, thus says the Lord God of Israel and his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts, I am the first and the last. Beside me, there is no God. Now, some will say, well, that's Jehovah God, right? They say, well, that's not Jesus. We know what Jesus says, I'm the Alpha and the Omega, but that can't be Jesus, because Jehovah is the Alpha and the Omega. So that has to be a reference back to Jehovah, where it's not Jesus anymore, and this is Jehovah in Isaiah 44. Okay, Isaiah 48, listen to me, O Jacob, O Israel, my called. I am he, the first, I am also the last. Jesus or Jehovah God? Is it either or is it both and? There you go, you're listening. Revelation 21, and he said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give the fountain of the water of life freely to him who thirsts. Now we know Jesus is the one that said, all who are thirsty come to me, right? He made that very, so he actually called himself God by saying that, as well as saying before Abraham was, I am. But still, there'll be arguments among the cults. Revelation 22, and behold, I am coming quickly, and my reward is with me, a reference to those clouds we just read about, to give to everyone according to his work. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Stop there. So some people will go, well, that's still Jehovah. Yeah, but here's the thing. Right there in the same chapter in verse 16, it says, I, Jesus. That's right. Boom, there it is. That's it. Who is the Alpha and the Omega? Who is the first and the last? It's Jesus. It's Jesus. It's Jesus. He's coming soon. See, he is the eternal one. When he says, I'm the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, he's referring to, I am that root from Jesse. I'm the Alpha. I'm the one that began. I'm the Messiah. I'm the first fruits. But this is incredible, and I believe this is inspired of the Holy Spirit, the way this was penned down. The word Alpha in the original manuscripts, the whole word Alpha is there, not just the letter A, but the whole word Alpha. But when he says Omega, it's just the O. It's not the whole word. Why? Because with God, there is no real end. He's eternal. See, guys, this is who we bank our promises on. When he says, you call me complete, you call me perfect, and you've given me complete unmerited favor with a peace that passes understanding. And all this is based on the eternal now God, who's omnipresent, all-sufficient to meet every need. And you've manifested that from heaven on earth through your own heart bleeding through flesh for me. and you're coming back to tie it all up together at the wedding feast. If the church would grab a hold of this family, it would radically alter what people perceive when they walk into a building. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we come before you as your bride today, thanking you for by grace we have been saved. That this was not of ourselves, but was a gift from you. So we pray for your bride here in these last days that you would help us to be a people of grace. A people, Lord, that walk with the Prince of Peace. God, take these seeds of faith, these words of life that have been spoken today from your word. And God, may you bring blessing. We stand upon your promise where it says, blessed are those who read the words of prophecy in this book. Lord, thank you for the blessing. In Jesus' name, amen. Family, God bless you. Have a wonderful week with Jesus.